house too. There was so much. But anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed Easter service and our Easter dinner and our time together. It was wonderful, I thought so.
Yes, it was.
I wanted to show you guys something, and I'm sorry I'm going to get her name wrong. Where?
Ellie?
Is it Ellie?
Yes.
Is it Ellie?
Yeah.
Look what Ellie made.
And Tinley.
And Tinley.
And Tinley, yes.
You guys see?
He made that for us.
He loves because he first loved us. 1 John 4:19.
Yes.
She made it for our church. Isn't that awesome? That makes me cry.
I know, didn't you?
Isn't that cool? I just love it. Thank you, sweetheart. Sweethearts. Both of you. Both of you girls, thank you. That is so sweet. I have a couple announcements. One, this Saturday, the Sisterhood is doing a self-sufficient class. It'll be held at the communication building or our fellowship building where we have lunch at 11 o'clock. 11 o'clock lunch will be served along with the devotion. All is welcome who would be interested in learning things such as canning, gardening, and such. I won't be there. The thing that I'm going to miss out on the most is the lunch. And the reason I'm not going to be there is because my husband is teaching Bible class in Siloam Friday and Saturday. And so I'm going to go over there and hopefully I can glean from some of his knowledge. And if you didn't know, he would be really mad if I told you guys this. But you guys are just all family, so probably most of you guys know. He went through school. Their Bible school, and my husband has a doctorate in theology, and Pastor Josh is working on his also, and so they ask him, this will be his second time that he gets to teach in Bible school, and this is the coolest thing. Listen, I don't know if I'm supposed to say this or not, but I'm going to, okay? I always get in trouble when I get this mic, every single time, and especially when he's not here, because when he's here, he gives me the eye, so I try not to look at him. So if you see me sometimes I'm going this way, it's because I don't want to look at him, because he'll give me, especially if he raises his eyebrows, like, uh-oh, we're in trouble. Yeah, right, like that, just exactly like that. So he's not here, so he can't raise his eyebrow at me, okay? So my husband had a word that he was going to be reaching the nations. That he was going to be reaching the nations. And so we're pretty small. I mean, hello, we're a jacket. We graduated from Pyrrhic High School. Okay, although my husband has went through Bible school and, you know, he's got it going on. We've been on many mission trips, especially him. But when I heard that word, I was like, wow, Lord, how's he going to reach the nations? I mean, that's a big thing. That's not like even the United States, you know? So when he teaches Bible school, all of his notes and everything that he teaches is sent to all the other Bible schools that's under Power and Light. And that's in Peru and all over the nations. It's sent, it's copied off in different languages and sent there, and somebody else will teach that same lesson that he has taught for the, is it how many hours?
6 hours.
It's a 6 hour class, yeah, on Friday night and Saturday. So when I've been praying for him, you know, because he's nervous, and so I've been praying for him through this week, and the Lord brought that up into my mind that he was going to reach the nations, and I was like, that's how he's going to reach the nations, because his teaching is going to go across the nations and be translated into different languages, and different people will teach that. So I'm so proud of you, Pastor Donnie. I'm so proud of you. Anyway, I would really get the eye and the eyebrow right then if I said that he was here. So anyway, I better wrap it up. He would be saying, wrap it up. That's what you're doing. Wrap it up. Sorry. I don't get to brag on him if he's not here, but I'm very, very proud of my husband. And he's accomplished a lot for the Lord, and his heart is to love people and to see people grow in the Lord and come to the Lord, and he's a pretty cool guy, okay? Even if he gives me an eyebrow sometimes. So the only other thing I have to let you guys know about, make sure you look on the bulletin board outside about the Kentucky trip to the Creation Museum and to Noah's Ark. I think we have 20-some already registered for that. That's great. We're excited about that. And you guys have Pastor Josh bringing the word tonight, so I know you guys are so excited about that. So thank you for being here. I'm just going to shut up now, wrap it up, and let the Lord do what he needs to do, okay? Father, we just thank you that your presence is already with us. We don't have to wait till we sing the first song or hear the first sound of the instrument. It's already here because your word says where two or three are gathered together in your name, that you are with us. And that's the only reason we came tonight, Lord. We didn't come for any other reason, Lord, is to be in your presence and to hear and to learn and grow closer to you. So we give you honor and praise tonight. We thank you that we can come freely into your house. We thank you for the word that Pastor Josh is going to bring to us. Let it be manna, marrow to our souls, Lord. Marrow to our souls. Let it go deep inside of us, Lord. Father, I thank you for the praise team as they lead us into your presence, Lord, into worship. We give you all of us tonight, Lord. We give you all of us tonight, Lord. Every hindrance, every obstacle, every thought that's not to you, Lord, we cancel it out. And we say, here we are, God. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Oh, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony in my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
God, invade hearts, God.
to do what only you know how to do, God, what only you're capable of, Jesus. We worship you. We worship you, Jesus.
Thank you.
playing in a platoon, and you guys know, if you've been here very long, this is like my favorite. It's my favorite song. And it's not because it sounds the best, it's because I'm so honored that I'm his girl. It's the coolest song to me that I just get to celebrate the fact that he called me up, he picked me up, he turned me around, he placed me somewhere that was a firm foundation. And I know that we just talk, that sounds like pretty church words, right? But it's true. It's true because I've been in here. I've been in this song. I've been here. But the coolest part about being his is that I think lots of times we get this like hate where it's like, oh, I have to be a Christian. This is the rules I have to follow. This is what I have to do. This is the yeses. This is the noes. This is whatever. And you know, when you're in a relationship with him, whenever you get to walk in this and just understand, I'm yours, God. Really, you have my heart. You have my focus. You have my attention. All of those things of like rules and regulation and whatever, it just falls off. Because you understand it's a privilege to be his. You understand it's a privilege to wear the name Christian. I'm his girl. I get to wear that. It's not a thing that I'm obligated to. It's a thing that I am honored to have. Amen? I want to share this for just a second. So, as you all know, I have recently moved out in the middle of the country. I'm officially like a country girl, okay? Not really, because I'm totally not, but... I was burning some trash the other day. My husband was laughing at me because I was like, I'm totally going to do this. It'll be fine. I can burn trash. I really can't, but I was going to try. So I have never done that before. Never in my life. I have a dad who's a rock star dad. I had a brother who was a rock star brother, and I'm married to the greatest man in the world. So I am kind of a princess. I'm just going to be honest. I don't do things like that. But I was determined I was going to do it. I was like, I can do this. Michael's at work. I can do this before he gets home. He's going to be so proud of me. I just thought I'm going to do it. So I got out there and I start on my big pile and I just have my little lighter, you know, and I'm like, I've got stuff stacked up crazy. And I was like, I'm just going to light this and it's just going to burn. It's going to be no big deal. I could not get the thing to catch on fire. And I was like, why is this so hard? It's cardboard. Like, I was burning boxes. We're unpacking, you know? So I was like, why will this not catch on fire? So I was like, I'm obviously a little bit blunt. And like, well, I thought that it would, but maybe cardboard won't. So I was like, there's some wood pieces in here. So I'll burn that. Wood burns, right? So I'm trying to light the wood. The wood will not catch on fire. I'm trying to light some other, like, there's just some trash in there. I'm trying to light that. It will not catch on fire. It will not with my little lighter. I don't know why I'm reminded of this. I just think it's such a cool representation. The Lord showed me this in this moment. But I found a paper towel, finally. I found a paper towel. And I was like, that is my option. So I got the paper towel, it immediately just went like, and so I threw it in there. I was like, oh, gotta get away from that. I threw it in there, the whole thing went into flames, and it was giant within like, I don't know, like 30 seconds. I mean, the whole thing was just, everything started melting, and like, the boxes started kind of crumbling, and everything's been, it is igniting because the fire is big enough that it's catching the other things, right? So when I was doing that, I was like, man, I've never done this, but I really didn't understand that so many things that are easily flammable are so hard to catch on fire. Like, it's hard. It's not that, like, cardboard is not flammable. It is. It's just that my one little tiny lighter with the wind was not enough to get it going. And the plastic and the glass and the, you know, whatever else was in there, it was sure not fixing to do that. But my little paper towel, it had it. It was ready. That paper towel was ready to catch the fire. And as I did that, I was like, God, what does that look like whenever you come in a room? Whenever you walk in a room, and I'm not calling us trash, okay, so don't get that. And I'm saying, when you walk in a room of all different kinds of materials, right? You walk in a room of all kinds of different backgrounds and culture and lifestyles and heart postures and whatever. You walk in this place. What does that look like? Because how many real paper towels are there in this thing? Yeah. How hard are you having to fight to get in here? Because really, that should be our desire, right? That whenever he walks in a room, we're just like, he's here. You know what I mean? Our hearts should just like explode with the passion and the hunger that we have, that we're so ready for that moment, that when he walks in, it doesn't take a lot. He doesn't have to stand there with a lighter 15 times and be like, oh, come on, come on, come on, come on. And we don't have to sing the right song and say the right words and get you all ready. The thing is, we're going to do that. We're going to do it. We're not going to stop doing it. But the point is what if?
What if we got in a heart posture where we said, I'm going to be so ready. I'm going to be so ready that whenever he walks in the room tonight, I'm going to be the one that starts it. I'm going to be the one that takes this thing. And what if more than one of us did that? Because you know what? If, say, I'm not very flammable. Say, I was a cardboard box, but Vanessa, she was that paper towel. And I was this close to her. The moment she got that, okay, I'm not being weird and saying, if you don't have an opening, you're not going to get anywhere. If you're like, don't talk to me, that's what it's going to be. But I'm saying, if Vanessa starts getting real fiery and blown up over here, and I'm this close, it didn't take very long for my cardboard to get a hold of her paper towel, okay? And I was blown up. And the person next to her and the thing next to her and the next, but what I'm saying is, what if we didn't just wait for Pastor Donnie or Pastor Josh or the praise team to like get the thing going? What if we just came in and we were like, you know what, Jesus, whatever you want tonight, I'm so here for it. I'm so ready. So just you come in and I'm just gonna jump right in that thing. Okay? What if we just did that? What if we just from right now? Because I can tell you this all day long and we can like ponder on it and come back Sunday and forget that Shaylee ever said anything, and that's fine with me because it's not about me. But from right now, from this moment, what if we just for a minute, without us singing any words or cheerleading anything or pulling something out, what if you just for a second could get personal in your heart and say, God, you know everything that's not supposed to be here and you can have it. And God, you know everything that you want to do inside of me and you can have it. So I'm ready. I'm ready. Come and burn inside of me. Come and set me on fire and let me set others on fire and let them set others on fire. And God, you just take over the place. You take over the room. It's all for you anyway, God. We just want you, God, you come and burn. You come and burn. We're honored. Come on, this is where that ties in. We're honored to wear your name. I'm honored to wear your name. I'm honored to be the little crazy girl on fire. I'm honored to be your son that's so loud and bright, God, that it's passing on to other people, Lord. I pray. I'm just honored to be your son.
When you fill the room, you're here and I know. Come to it again. Thank you, Lord. 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 I love you, Jesus. Did you guys just say this with me? Holy Spirit, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. Aaron done broke his string.
Yeah.
I see that. I see that. He was jamming, man. Well, I want you to know that I don't talk to Pastor Shaylee when she's preparing her song list. I don't tell her what I'm preaching. In fact, it was about noon, and I was sitting in my little office chair, and I was just asking the Lord, and I had a lot of really good stuff that the Lord has showed me, you know, like good stuff, you know, like where you put down really good stuff. And I was like, man, I could use some of that really good stuff. But none of it just felt right. And so I was just sitting before the Lord. And I'm like, all right, God, you know, it's like 12:30. And he just said, I want you to talk about the Holy Spirit and burning in the Holy Spirit. And I want you to know, I had to talk to Shaylee. And then when she sent out her song list and I seen that the last song was Come Rest on Us, I thought, God, you are so cool. But my printer couldn't print my little notes out, and so I'm a laptop preacher tonight. Amen. Is that okay? You guys okay?
Yeah.
You guys alive?
Yeah.
Is Jesus Lord or is he not?
Yeah.
Is Jesus Lord or is he not? Yeah. Come on, he is. He never stopped being Lord.
Right. Thank you, Jesus.
Man, I love you so much, Jesus. I love you so much, Holy Spirit. I do want to talk about the Holy Spirit. Before I start, I want you to know that I was very timid to tackle this, because the Holy Spirit, it's not that he's complicated or difficult, but it's just that I so honor him and reverence him. I want to give him the honor that's due to the Holy Spirit. And so tonight when I was talking about the Holy Spirit, as I was praying, seeking the Lord, fellowshipping with the Holy Spirit, I was just like, God, just Holy Spirit, you do it, because this is all you. Like when Jesus says, there's amazing things that the Lord says about the Holy Spirit. One of them was this: every blasphemy that men may utter against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but whoever blasphemes the Holy Ghost will not be forgiven. And so that tells me two things. Well, first thing it tells me is how much Jesus values the Holy Spirit. And if you ever notice, the least valued person in the Godhead is who? But if anybody blasphemes the Father and the Son, they're forgiven. But if they blaspheme the Holy Ghost, they're not. So that tells me how much they value, how valuable the Holy Ghost is in the Godhead. And I know that in my heart and my soul and my mind. And so I'm always very reverent when I talk about the subject of the Holy Spirit. I was visiting my dear brother. I call him Papa Robert. And he's like, I love hanging out with Papa Robert. And he was just talking about being led by the Holy Spirit today. And it was just confirming stuff he was doing in my heart. And anyway, and so there's just amazing. I don't want to talk about the second thing that tells me about the Holy Spirit. You go pray about it. And I just don't feel like I need to. And so I do want to tell you this, that we serve a triune God. God the Father, yeah? God the Son, Jesus Christ, and God the Holy Spirit. He's three in one. And so we must always remember one thing. When we're worshiping God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They're three in one. They're three distinct persons in unity. And they completely and perfectly represent one another. And I read this statistic today, and I was like, whoa. Did you know they did a survey, and they surveyed a lot of Christians, and 51% of people said the Holy Spirit is a force and not a person? That's wrong. He's a person. Listen to me. God ministered in the Old Testament. Jesus ministered in the Gospels. Now the Holy Spirit ministers the New Testament. God ministered the Old Testament. Jesus ministered Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And now the Holy Spirit is given to us to be ministers now in the New Covenant through us. That's the job of the Holy Spirit. Do you see the importance of the Holy Spirit? So if the enemy can cause confusion and division, because there's never been more division over anything in the body of Christ than the subject of Holy Ghost. And so if the enemy can come in and cause division about the amazing, precious person of the Holy Spirit, what's he doing? He's taking power away from us. The Bible says in Galatians, you have received the Spirit by faith, and he's the one who works miracles among you. And now you're thinking that you're going to be perfected by works. He's like, no, that isn't right. And so he's the one, so you got to catch what he's saying though. He's saying the Holy Spirit's the one doing the ministering in your service. He's the one that's justified you. He's the one that's making you holy. He's the one that's purifying you. He's the one that's strengthening you. And that one, that very one you think you now have to work in the flesh, when you've received the Holy Spirit by faith through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord Jesus, get this, get this. The Lord Jesus dwells in you in the Holy Spirit. The Lord Jesus dwells in you in the person of the Holy Spirit. Do you see how precious the Holy Spirit is? Listen, God made the plan for our redemption. God made the plan for our redemption. He began it. We see it in Genesis. Whenever they sinned, God kills the sheep, right? Clothes Adam and Eve. It was a foreshadow of Jesus one day going to be the sacrificial lamb of God. Listen, God made the plan. You can read about it in your Bible. Jesus fulfilled the plan, and now the Holy Spirit reveals the plan. God made the plan. Jesus fulfilled the plan. Holy Spirit reveals the plan. And so it's in the Holy Spirit we see the revelation of our redemption. It's only by the Holy Spirit we can get understanding of who we really are in God. Of who we really are now that Jesus Christ has come and fulfilled our Father's plan. I'm going to talk about all this more. Are you guys okay? We're going to get into some stuff in a second. Listen, I think it's so important. A lot of this stuff is going to sound elementary, but it's so important you keep this foundation clear. I had a dream the other night, and I seen a foundation, and it was covered, it was caked real thick with mud. And in my dream, I spent all night, and I was shoveling mud off this foundation. I've done that before, so we can nail pins to lay block. And so before the house is ever built, the foundation was covered in mud, and I was just scraping mud off the foundation. Tonight, I feel like I'm scraping some mud off the foundation. Listen, we talk about God the Father, we talk about Jesus Christ, Lord, often, but we must always give place to the Holy Spirit. Everybody says with me, Holy Spirit, I give you place. See, the Holy Spirit comes and dwells what you make available to him. The Holy Spirit is so kind. He's so sweet. And see, what you make available, he'll come and fill. And there's a lot of people that walk around in the flesh and not the Spirit. And so that's what they're reproducing is the flesh and not the Holy Spirit. And I love you. I feel in my heart that religion and bad experiences have made people weirded out by the person of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
You ever mentioned the word Holy Spirit to somebody and they even start sweating?
You say,
and you're like, that's him right now. He wants in there.
Yeah.
See, people are weirded out by the Holy Spirit, but you have to understand something. I really want you to see this clear, that Jesus perfectly, perfectly represented the Father to us. Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And the Holy Spirit will perfectly represent Jesus. And so the Holy Spirit's not going to do something in you and through. He's going to do stuff in you and through you that don't make sense.
Yeah.
But he's not going to do something in you and through you to harm you.
Yeah,
that's right.
You guys with me? And so it may not make sense in your natural mind. It don't make sense in my mind. Some of the stuff that God does to people when the Holy Spirit really comes on somebody. But here's the thing. When somebody has walked for 25, 30, 40 years, bound in addiction, bound by lies in their mind by the enemy, and the Holy Spirit begins to fill them, beginning to shake, and they begin to roll on the floor, and they're being set free. I don't really care what it looks like. I'm just glad that person's getting up and being free. And if that makes you feel uncomfortable, I don't really care, because I care more about that person being free than I do about your feelings. I care about that person waking up that next day full of fire, full of drive, full of passion, full of who he is, more than being full of addiction and lies and things from the enemy. I care about that more.
Come on.
See, it's in Psalms 115. I can tell you what God does. I'll be like, well, that wasn't in my Bible, brother. I didn't know people would shake like that. Yeah, it's in Psalms 115. They're like, what? It's like, God does what he pleases.
Come on.
God does what he pleases. And I'm going to let him have his way. When the supernatural realm, when the Holy Spirit's the bridge that connects this world to the heaven.
Yeah.
And when the Holy Spirit comes and begins to manifest and does what he does, it's not going to make sense to your natural mind because it's not a natural thing.
Yeah.
It's a supernatural one. That's why Jesus says the things of the Spirit the world cannot receive. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, the things of the Spirit is foolishness to those who are in the flesh. It don't make sense. Well, I don't care if it makes sense. I care if people are free. And he's a God of freedom. He's the Spirit of freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is
freedom.
Get it?
Hey.
A But I want you to understand, you have to get, they perfectly represent one another. So just as Jesus showed us the Father, which is the cornerstone of our belief, doctrine, and theology, is the person Christ Jesus. You've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you're believing something about God that you don't see in the life of Jesus in the Gospels, it's wrong belief.
Come on.
He is perfect theology.
Perfect.
Perfect theology. Go to John chapter 14. I'm going to start in verse 15. Are you guys okay? Listen, I used to think.
Come on, Pastor.
Oh, Lord Jesus. You know the song, "You provide the fire, I'll provide the sacrifice"? No, that song's backwards. You provide the sacrifice, and then he sends the fire.
Yeah.
And there's so many times we still hold on to ourselves. We are so... I felt this real strong in the room a second ago. We are so self-conscious, self-aware of what we're walking through, of the current situation. I know it's real, and I'm not taking away from it, because I know it's a real thing you're walking through. Everybody's walking through things all day. You can make that so big. You can get that so big in your heart that it completely robs you of your joy, robs you of your thanksgiving, robs you of your communion with the Lord, and you blow up this thing that you're walking through so big. You become so self-conscious, so self-aware. You're totally missing God in the room, who he is in you and through you, how he wants to change you and transform you. You're missing communion and intimacy with him because you're looking at everything else. I know everybody's walking through something. The enemy just didn't wake up and pick on you today. Everybody's walking through something, and everybody has a choice today to wake up and either meditate and glorify what the enemy's doing, or you can meditate and glorify what God has done and what he's doing.
Yeah.
Everybody, listen, everybody likes to make their bed in hell, but the psalmist David wrote about it. He said, if I can go to heaven, God, you're there. I can go to the farthest parts in the sea. There you are. I made my bed in hell because I like to be comfy in my self-pity, but even you found me there and took me out of that place.
Yeah.
That's what we do. It's what natural man does. That's what we do in our natural. We want to turn on the sad music, let the lights down, we'll go listen to the sad music. Oh. Man, get up. Get up out of that. Throw it off. There's more for you. And I know what you're walking through is real, and I know it's serious, but there's a greater revelation. There's a greater reality. And his name, Jesus Christ the Lord. And he took a cross so that the sin would lose its dominion off of your life.
Yes.
But if you never commune with the Holy Spirit, talk to, communicate with the Holy Spirit, the one who makes that real in our lives, God will just be a thought in your mind. The Holy Spirit is the one that takes from knowing God in your mind to making him real in your heart.
Yes.
Wow. That's only the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
See, so many times we do all the right things. We sing the right songs. Maybe you're doing all the right devotion life. And maybe you're doing all the things you're supposed to be doing, but it's not being very effective. I'm telling you, it's missing one thing. The power of the Holy Ghost.
Come on.
The power of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
If you're doing something in your life that's not producing life, you're doing it outside of the Holy Ghost.
That's right. That's good.
Holy Ghost. Who said it?
Mama.
Holy Ghost.
Mama. That was Mama's voice.
I could just hear. She's like a Holy Ghost. You can hear his spurs clicking.
Where's the devil at?
That's your mama.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Really, there you go. Where am I going? Where did I send you? 15? Verse 15. Holy Ghost. Verse, are you guys okay?
Yes, amen.
The Holy Spirit is so amazing. I want you to understand. I want you to just catch a few things to help you. That because the Holy Spirit is so strange to people. He's a person. We're about to read it. How Jesus speaks of him. I want you to understand he perfectly represents Jesus. And he does other things. And we're going to talk about that. But I want you to catch those things. Because that's a big deal. You have to build your belief in that place. You guys with me? Okay. I'll stop. Verse 15. Listen to what Jesus says. Listen, he says, if you love me.
Mm-hmm.
Man, just catch that comma. Pause and stuff like that. Don't glaze over that. You know, that's deep, man. That's a lot. If you love me, keep my commandments. Listen to verse 16. This is why I say, you provide the sacrifice, then he provides the fire. Because
mm-hmm.
that verse right there, if you love me, keep my commandments. He's not talking about being in a place of works. He's talking about being in a place of communion, fellowship, and love and intimacy with him. Do you catch that? Loving him is fulfilling the commandments. Verse 16 says, and I will pray the Father. Everybody say Father.
Father.
That's big. That's big. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another. Everybody say another.
Another.
Helper. That he may abide with you. Oh, listen to that word. Forever. Isn't that beautiful?
Amen.
The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. Listen to how he calls him. What does he call him? A him. They say an it or a wind.
Right.
He says it. Him. Not like under garment. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. He's saying you already know him because you've seen me. That's what he's saying.
Yeah.
Listen to what he says now. I will not leave you orphans. Everybody say orphans.
Orphans.
I will come to you. That's so important. Listen, the Holy Spirit is a person. And listen, if he is a person, that means what? He can be experienced.
Yeah.
If he's a person, he can be experienced. He can be touched.
Yes.
He can be fellowshiped with. He can be in communion with the Holy Spirit. And we have to begin to do that in your prayer life. Begin to do that in your everyday commune and fellowship with this beautiful, precious person called the Spirit of Truth, who will lead you and guide you into all truth. Listen, this is what he's like. He's like our amazing personal representative of the will and testament of Jesus Christ. Not the will of like something I want to do, but like the will that somebody wrote down. Will, there's a will and a testament, which is important. Why? Because a will is what somebody writes down, like this is my land, this is my house. And then a testament is like this is my personal goods. Jesus has given us both the will and testament. What's the Holy Spirit do? This is the Holy Spirit's job in our lives. And this is why it's so important to get to know the Holy Spirit. I'm trying to settle down, but I'm about to lose my mind.
Come on.
The Holy Spirit goes, Josh, this is what Jesus paid for because he died for you on the cross and he rose again. And so therefore, sin lost its power. Death lost its power over you. Sickness lost its power over you. Addiction lost its power over you. And he's declaring to me the will, what belongs to me now as the Son of God, through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He says, this is yours now through the Word of God. That's what he does. He shows us our divine rights. Everybody say
divine
rights. He shows us our divine rights. He says, this is yours because Jesus Christ broke open the will and testament because he died.
Yeah.
Then he rose again. Therefore, the will and testament became in effect because the will and testament is not in effect unless if the person's still living. And so everything that God willed for us was still locked up until he died. But when he died, it was broke open. And all of a sudden, he goes, come home, son. Come home, daughter. It's my will for you. Come home, son. Come home, daughter. That's my will for you. I made a plan for you that I would redeem your life through my son, Jesus Christ. Come home, son. Come home, daughter.
Yeah.
You guys get it? That's the job. That's why. Do you see how important it is to know the Holy Spirit? Because apart from that, you'll just know it in your mind. This is what happens to people. You'll just know it in your mind, and you won't see the fruit of it in your lives. And then you'll think God short-strawed you or something. Because you just know it with your mind and not your heart. Does that make sense? Man, I feel like I'm just hitting a wall.
No,
that's
good.
Okay.
It's good.
Listen, the Holy Spirit gives us our inheritance. It gives us our inheritance now. See, religion, sensual, carnal thinking tells you that our full redemption is purchased when we die. No, that means death still plays a part in redemption, but it does not. You are as right with God right now as you will be the day you make heaven. And it has to be that way. Because if it was any other way, he couldn't even look at you, see you, or be in a relationship with you because he's perfect and holy. And so what did he have to make you so he could know you and see you and look at you? Perfect and holy. And that will never be real to you unless you see that by the power of the Holy Spirit that's inside of you. Unless you know the will and testament.
Oh my.
Listen.
Come on.
Come on, he gives us the will. He says things like this. He says, I'm going to go prepare a place for you, Jerome. In my Father's house, there's many mansions. That's his will. He's saying, this is my possession I'm preparing for you, that you're going to inherit. But then he says things like, I'm going to give you my joy. I'm going to give you my peace. That's his testament. That's his personal. It's saying, I'm going to give you my love, Jordan. So when you love people, you're not loving them from you. You're loving them from me. He gives us the will and the testament. Okay, I'm going to skip some of that. Go to Romans chapter 8, verse 2. I kind of like having my computer here so I can see the time. And I'm not doing good. Romans 8 verse 2. This is, I wanted to read a lot of this, but man, I want to read this. I want to read this. Father, thank you, Jesus. Romans 8 verse 2. Say amen when you do. I want you to see it. I want you to flip there. I know you trust me to read it, but I want you to see it. Romans 8 2. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Listen, there's a superior revelation in the New Testament that the Bible actually says that there was glory in the Old Covenant, but the New Covenant is so glorious that it makes the Old Covenant not look like it even has any glory, even though it was glorious. Yes. That's how much glory is in the New Covenant, in the New Testament, in the New Will. Sorry, I kind of butchered that. Drum smiling at me like, you almost had it, buddy. Romans 8, 2 says, listen, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, everybody say life. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. Amen. Hallelujah. Do you see the law of the Spirit of life? So living this life in the Spirit with communion and relationship with God through the Holy Spirit has made me free from the law of sin and death. Listen, the Bible says it like this, that the wages of sin is death. And so when people are sinning, people think they're the boss. But the truth is, sin's their boss because bosses don't get wages. Bosses give wages. And so if you're getting wages, that means you're on the receiving end of the deal. So that means sin's your master. And under the law, there was a response to sin. There was a consequence to sin. And that's why there is sickness. That's why there's disease. That's why there's anxiety. That's why there's depression. There's these fallen things that we live in and deal with because the law of that law, that lesser law. Does that make sense, you guys? I'm butchering this. It sounded really good when I was put together in my office. Let me say it like this. In the Old Testament, if you touched a leper, you were unclean.
Yeah.
But now in the New Testament, with the Spirit, when you touch a leper, now the leper's clean.
That's right. That's right.
Because there's a greater revelation, there's a greater law. Why? Because it's the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made you free from the law of sin and death.
Amen. Wow.
Yeah. Come on, that's everything about the Spirit is life. If there's something in your life that's not producing spirit or not producing life, it's apart from the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Just like in the beginning, when God created Adam, the Bible says it just like this. It says that God formed man from the dust. So there he was. There's a comma right there. God formed man from the dust. There's a comma. So there was man in his fullness. He wasn't halfway done. He was a full man. Had eyes, nose, teeth, a heart, all the organs he needed to function, hands, brain. He was completely done. But yet he wasn't alive. He still laid there. He was a dead man. And that's how we are apart from the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, come on. Mm-hmm.
And next is God breathed into his nostrils. Come on. Can you imagine? You have to picture stuff like that. The intimacy that God has with us. And then he stood up and became a living being. I want you to understand something. Jesus died as a man. The Bible actually says that he is the Spirit of truth and that the spirit of error has come. You know what the spirit of error is? It's people that don't confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. That is actually the spirit of the Antichrist. And it is growing rampant right now all over America and teachings that people are saying that Jesus did not come in the flesh. But it's so important that Jesus came in the flesh because God couldn't redeem man. Flesh had to redeem man. And so God came in flesh to redeem flesh. And so if he didn't come in the flesh, he never really redeemed us.
Yeah.
And so you have to understand when Jesus was laying in the grave, Jesus didn't raise Jesus from the grave. The Holy Spirit raised Jesus from the grave. Wow. And just like Adam laid there lifeless, Jesus laid there lifeless. But there was the Holy Spirit that came and quickened him. The Bible says it like this, the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the grave dwells in you. And if it's given Adam life, and if it's given Jesus life, it's giving you life. The Holy Spirit comes in every organ, in every fiber of your being, and gives you life. That's why we're healed. That's why it says next, and he quickens our mortal body. If you need strength in your body, it's the Holy Spirit. You need strength in your mind, it's the Holy Spirit. You need strength in your witness, it's the Holy Spirit. He gives us life, and everything apart from him is not life.
Yeah.
It's a superior law. It's the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Come on, you have to get that. And that's from that place, man, you can just receive healing so much.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit's in every... It wasn't just a spiritual transaction, Ed. It had to have been, because if it was, if it was only a spiritual transaction, Jesus' body would still be in the grave and his spirit would arise. That's not what happened. Jesus comes back and he says, touch me. See, I'm not a spirit. He even says, give me some grindage. Give me some fish. Food. That's grindage food. See that I'm not a spirit. Dead, Kyle. It's life. It's life. Listen, John 14, 18. So, the spirit is life. I want you to catch that. He's life. You've probably heard me reference this a lot, but now I'm going to show you in Scripture. I call it the spirit of sonship. The spirit of sonship. In your Bibles while you're in Romans, let's jump over to verse 12. Let's read some. We're going to read 12 to 17. I just want to read some scripture. And I just want you to see how many references. And actually, I'm just going to show you a few. We just read one in John. And I'm going to show you three more of when the Holy Spirit is talked about. It's always in direct connection with us being sons and daughters of God. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. That's what he is showing us as the will and testament of God. Listen, Romans 12 says, therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. Listen to what he says. This is his word. For if you live according to the flesh, you'll die. But if by the Spirit, you can't put to death the deeds of the body in your own strength. There's no 12-step, 24-step, 100-step. There is a by the Spirit.
Yeah.
And if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. Everything about him is life. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God.
Amen.
Did you see that? He's the spirit of sonship. Listen, he goes on further. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear. Hold your finger there. Listen, he's not talking about fear like a fear of man or fear of doing something new or fear of public speaking. He's talking about the fear of standing before your father and thinking that he's going to strike you down because of the inferior law.
That's right.
Because if you think like that, you're not thinking like a son, you're thinking like a servant. Servants come trembling before their master. Sons come running home.
Come on.
He's talking about living under the fear of the Old Testament. Well, listen, Ed, if we had to be fearful of God, we'd never be intimate with him. And he's invited us to an intimate relationship,
yeah.
Communion. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Father. Do you get it? Listen to what he says. But you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. Hold your finger there. We see adoption. But I want you to think about it like this. When somebody adopts somebody, it's because they chose them. You've received the spirit of, he chose me.
Yeah.
He wanted me. People just don't go out and just adopt kids. People go out and they choose kids.
Yeah.
Because they want them to be in the family. And so we say adoption, but really God's saying you're chosen.
Wow.
I chose you. You can take stuff like that by the Holy Spirit. The love of God just blow up. Right, and that's what it does. It just blows up in your heart. He chose me. When nobody else wanted me, I was on the sideline. I didn't even believe in me. He was choosing me.
Come on.
My worst day, my worst moment, still living in sin, the Holy Spirit said, hey, I opened up a will and a testament saying, son, come running home. And you don't have to come trembling. You can come running to a father who loves you, who paid a high price to have you.
Yeah.
Duh. He chose you. And we cry out. Listen to what we cry. Do you see what the Holy Spirit does in you? Only see, he's saying the Holy Spirit's the only one that cries this out in you. You can think that in your mind and it'll be cool for a moment. Or you can believe it in your heart and the Holy Spirit can show you and you'll live it forever.
Come on.
It's only by the Holy Ghost. And we cry out, Abba, Father, Father, Abba, Abba, Dad, Daddy, Daddy. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. I want you to see the Spirit. Everybody say this with me. Spirit,
spirit
of sonship. Go to Galatians chapter 4. Can I just keep reading Scripture?
Yeah.
I don't have to hold the Word up. He holds his Word up. Galatians chapter 4. Let's read verses 1 through 6. Let's just keep reading this. I just showed you four of them. But a lot of times when you see the Holy Spirit, you're going to see it in direct connection with Father. I had a dream not too long ago about this. And in my dream, I was sitting in a class, and there was an old gentleman, and he was teaching the class, and I was sitting off to the right, and he was doing an excellent job. What he was teaching was very good, it was very deep, it was very profound, and I was very impressed. And I was watching this man teach in my dream, and he stepped back, and his face kind of got puzzled, and he said, "Sometimes cancer is just the will of God." And I started crying, and I walked up to him. This is what I said. I put my hand on him like this, and I said, "Brother, the only reason you think that's because you don't think like a son, you think like a servant." And that man stood there and just wept. And he wept and he wept and he wept. And I woke up. There's some things that we won't. We will refuse to walk in because the Holy Spirit showed us who we are.
Come on, that's good.
Verse 1 says, "Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, though he is a master of all, but is under guardians and stewards until the time appointed by the Father. Even so we," everybody say we, "even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world." Listen, listen to me. Sensual, carnal, rational thinking is your enemy.
Yep.
It's your enemy.
It is the enemy.
It's your enemy.
Come on.
There's no other way but the way, Christ Jesus. If it's healing, it's Jesus. If it's freedom, it's Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
If it's a prodigal, it's Jesus.
Amen.
If it's a marriage, it's Jesus. If it's finances, it's Jesus. And so then we have all this sensual, rational thinking. We trust and rely and go all these different ways. When the Holy Spirit's saying, "Why are you living in bondage to all these other things?" When I'm right here saying, "You are a child of God. And if you're a child, he's going to take care of you."
Yeah,
don't look to the left or look to the right. Look to your Father.
Yeah.
He loves you. And you're still living. Children live under bondage to the elements. Children live in that sensual carnal thinking. That's what children do. Oh God, the Holy Spirit shut me up. But when the fullness of the time had come, that's when Jesus had come. Now Jesus has come. Now we can see. The veil's been rent. What does that mean? We can see. The way into the holiest of all has been made. God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying out, "Abba, Father." Therefore, you are no longer a slave. Say, "I'm not a slave."
Not a slave.
I'm not a slave. I'm a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Can we read one more? Can we just keep going? Yeah, I love this. She's loving it. You have a good friend here. Go to Luke chapter 11. You guys okay? If you get done before I do, leave. I don't care. Verse 9 says, Luke chapter 11, verse 9 says, "So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, it will be opened. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask of him?" Do you see that? You believe? No, I dare you. You just so believe that he's your Father and he loves you. You ask him to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Because when you get saved, he's in you. But then you get baptized and then he's on you. He's in you so you bear fruit. That's what you'll be judged by. You're not going to be judged by your gifts. You're going to be judged by your fruit.
Come on.
But he's in you for your eternal sake. And he's on you for other people's eternal sake. He's on you for gifts. He's in you for fruit. And you just so... Man, Brother Joseph, you just so ask God, "You're my Father, you love me. I ask that you give me the Holy Spirit so that I can overcome this thing, I can walk through all this by the power of the Holy Spirit because you love me. You're my Father, I see it in the Word, and your Word doesn't lie, God, I thank you." See how easy that is? Can we keep going?
Yeah.
Come on. Oh, I want to read some of this. Listen, servants think rejection, sons think acceptance. Servants think sickness, sons think health. Servants will work to receive wages, and sons will receive their inheritance.
Amen.
Listen, if I'm a bride, girls, you can be a son.
Right.
But I'm a smoking hot bride. That's a big bet.
Oh my God.
Sons will always be servants, but servants will never be sons. Sons abide in the house forever. Okay, I want to read one last scripture. I just want to talk about the fire of the Holy Spirit. I talked about that for a second. Listen, he's in you and you get saved, but then there's a baptism. It's when he comes upon you.
Yeah.
And he baptizes you. That's the part where there seems to be no dignity. It's not a fruit of the Holy Ghost. And I'm glad. I remember I was actually with Jerome Todd, and we was in Dallas, and I got violently, that's the best word I could use, violently baptized with the Holy Spirit and fire. And the best way I could explain it is I was telling God if he didn't stop that I was going to die. And I had a string of snot drums that it was 3 foot long. I was crying. And he was so gracious to me. We was driving back from Dallas, and I would just start crying randomly. He'd be talking to me, just telling about Jesus. And I would just start crying, and he would stop talking and just turn the worship music on a little bit louder. And then when I stopped crying, he'd turn it down and just keep talking. And then I would start crying, and he would stop talking and turn the music up a little bit. And I did that for about 3 days. My heart was so ravaged by God, but I was never the same. He marked me.
Yeah.
He brands you. But the Lord only comes and does that to very hungry, humble people.
Yes.
Man, I say that just as humbly as I can. He only does that when he's the only thing that matters.
Yeah.
Let me read you these scriptures. Let me read Revelation chapter 4, verse 6. The Lord just showed me this. Actually, at prayer service last night. I'm almost done, guys. Revelation chapter 4, verse 6. Let's just read this. This is the throne room. I'm just going to start in verse 1. Is that okay?
Yeah.
It's the word. After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. Immediately I was in the spirit, behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. One did. And he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardius stone in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne, in appearance like an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their head. And from the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices. Seven lamps of fire. Everybody say fire. Seven lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Seven in your Bible means complete. It's the fullness of the Holy Spirit burning with fire before the throne. Listen to verse 6. It says, before their throne, there was a sea of glass. Everybody say, sea of glass.
Sea of glass.
Sea of glass like crystal. I want to pause right there. There's a lot you can talk right there, but I want you to see the sea of glass like crystal. Now, in Revelation still, go to chapter 15. Chapter 15. Watch this. I found this in my Bible. It's amazing, Blair. It's in there. I didn't make it up. Sometimes I'm like, this is too good. It's going to sound like I made it up. That's in the Word. There was a sea of glass. Listen, Revelation chapter 15, verse 2, and he says, and I saw something like a sea of glass. This time, what's different? It's mingled with fire. Come on. And those who have the victory over the beast, over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, standing on the sea of glass, having harps of God, and they sing the song of Moses. It's the song of deliverance. Why? How did they overcome? By Holy Ghost fire. And when the people of God came in that had been martyred for the word of God, and they're standing before their throne, this time the sea of glass has a response. This time it's mingled with fire. Why? God's trying to show us something. It's by the fire of the Holy Ghost that we get the victory.
Yeah.
It's how we get deliverance.
Wow.
Now, this time that the saints are standing in the throne room, this time the sea of glass is mingled with fire. Because the saints that burned with fire are standing in there. It's how you overcome sin. It's how you overcome addiction. If you want to burn with fire, if you want to know why you don't want to pray, it's because you don't burn with fire. If you want to know why you don't want to fast, you don't burn with fire. Why you don't want to fellowship, you don't burn with fire. You have to have the fire of God in and on your life. And that only comes when you repent, willfully choose Jesus every second, every day. You're turning from your sin, turning towards Jesus, choosing to follow him. He becomes your main pursuit, the reason why you're alive. The why you woke up this morning was to burn for Jesus. through the Holy Spirit. And when He becomes your main hunger, main pursuit, main desire, you'll be answered with fire.
Yeah.
Every great move of God that began was because a group of people came together and they was hungry for something more. They were hungry for something more than just church. They were hungry for something more than just religion, than just going through the motions. They wanted the Holy Spirit. And see, when the fire comes, you can't care what you look like. It doesn't matter what you like. It doesn't matter if people know you. It doesn't matter if people love you. It doesn't matter if people approve you. The Holy Spirit burns all that up in your life. It doesn't matter anymore, except that the Holy Spirit glorified my Lord Jesus. Doesn't matter what people say, think, or do, you're willing to give it all for that fire. And you guard that fire. And you guard your conscience. And I'm not going to look at that. And I'm not going to watch that. Because my heart's been set ablaze by truth. My heart's been set ablaze by the Holy Ghost. And I will sell everything if I have to keep that and guard that fire that He's placed in my heart. Because I value the fire. Because at the end of the day, it's how we get the victory. If you want to know why you're stuck in the same cycle, you don't burn with fire.
Come on.
And it only happens if you're hungry. And that only comes by pursuit.
Yeah.
It's if you get so sick of it. Aren't you sick of it?
Come on.
Aren't you done?
Come
pursue.
On.
Who cares, Amy? Because if the house is on fire, everybody's got to burn.
Yeah. Come on, Pastor.
Set it on fire.
Good.
Woo.
Set it on fire.
Come on, Pastor.
Who cares what your children say? Who cares what your spouses say? Who cares? If the house is on fire, everybody's going to burn.
Amen.
You set it on fire. Set it on fire with truth. And you guard that thing. It's holy. It's precious. It's what's before the throne. The fire of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And that's where if you want the fire, that's where you have to stand constantly before the throne. You guys with me? Would you stand with me? I don't know what else to pray, just except for a baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire. Listen, he's good. He's not going to hurt you. He's not going to harm you. And he's willing to do anything it takes to set you free. And I really believe that there's just, man, it's one thing to be free, and it's another to be free indeed.
Yes.
And I feel like there's such a free indeed when that Holy Spirit consumes your life. There's a free indeed.
Yeah.
And that's what I want for you. I want you to be free indeed. Never again.
Thank you, Jesus.
Never again. Are we going back to Egypt? Never again. Yeah. You burn this fire. I'm going to pray for you guys. Would you just put your hand on somebody next to you? Listen, and how it happened for me is not, that's not how it's going to be for everybody. I feel like some of you are going to be, the Lord's going to wake some of you up at 3 a.m. and you're going to be shaking in your bed, wondering what's happening to you. Let it happen. It's the Holy Spirit who loves you. Let Him in. Let Him in. Let Him have you. Some of you may be folding laundry, doing dishes, and the Holy Spirit begins to come upon you more and more and more. Let Him in. Let Him have you. Dishes can be done later. Dishes can be later. Come on, however it happens for you. The main thing is you just continue to place yourself before God hungry for the Lord. Father, send the fire. Holy Spirit, I ask right now, from the right to the left, in Jesus' name, fire come. Fire come, begin to burn up every bit of chaff, every bit of impurity, begin to burn it up. Holy Spirit, we ask you for Holy Ghost fire. We want you. Holy Spirit, we want you. We want you more than anything, more than the next meal, more than the next whatever it is, God. We want you more, Holy Spirit. We want you more, Holy Spirit. No matter what it looks like, no matter what it takes right now, all over the room, fire burn in hearts right now. Mark us forever. Holy Spirit, mark us forever. Holy Spirit, brand us. Mark us, Holy Spirit. Mark us with fire. Let us be a people marked by fire, Lord. Mark us, Holy Spirit. Come. Holy Spirit, right now, burn it up. Burn up all the trash. Burn up all the junk in our hearts. Burn up all the lies in our mind. Burn them up. Burn it up. Burn up every insecurity. Burn up every past pain right now. Burn up every past regret. Burn up every shame. Right now, burn it up, Holy Spirit. We throw it in the fire. We throw it in the fire right now, God. We're people of fire. We're people of fire. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, fire come. Jesus' name, fire come. Father, thank you. Jesus' name, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on. There's more. There's more. Go get it. Go get it. Thank you, Jesus. There's more. Do you want to keep pushing? Let's keep pushing. I feel like there's somebody in here that needs a deep encounter with the Lord. I feel like there's somebody in here that needs a deep encounter with the Lord. Yeah, right there. Right here. It is up there. It's you. It is. Joseph, will you come up here? Just bring him up. You're not in the same place anywhere when you got here. That's what this means. You're in a different place now. You may have walked in one way, but now you're walking out another. Holy Spirit, you have a family here that loves you, and He's burning it up right now. He's burning it up right now. Holy Spirit, I'm on fire. In Jesus' name, thank you, Lord. Yes, right now, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, you're like a dam, brother. It's been dammed up. We release it right now in Jesus' name. We release it right now in Jesus' name. Being broken right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Yes, right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Jesus, thank you. We love you. We love you. Yes, Lord. Oh, God. Yes, Lord.
Thank you.
God, there's men in the room. There's men in the room. Men of God. That, I mean, I was just going to say it, that I need your surrender. And I'm not trying to prolong this thing. If you believe, you can go. But there's, God wants more for you. God wants more for you. And I feel like there's things you need to surrender in your heart. There's things you need to lay down. And so I want to invite you, just an act of humility, not to make you a spectacle, just an act of humility, to humble yourself and come to the front and get on your knees before the Lord and surrender to the Lord. And I feel like there's men in the room. I really do. I feel like there's God wants to take you deeper in places in your life for your family. So you be the rightful man of God in your house. And there's more men in here. There's more men in here. I feel like there's deep encounters in here for men of God in the room. Just for more of God. And then to take your rightful place as the man of God in their home.
Thank you, Jesus.
It's an act of humility, of surrender. There's more. There's more. There's more.
Ghost on you also. that you would be a force to be reckoned with, both of you together. That your family would change your family. That your family would change your street. That your family will change your workplace. That your family will change your church. That your family will change your children. That your family will change your grandchildren together.
Come on, giants, giants fall.
When you
stand undefeated, every battle you won, I am who you
say I am.
You crown me, you crown me.
With confidence, I see
it. In the heavenly place, under, by the power, come on, by the power of your name. I'm seeing in heaven, in the undefeated, with the one who has conquered it all.
Oh.